co-published an opinion piece which really focused attention on the kind of lack of women leaders, particularly in arts institutions which are at the kind of larger scale, the kind of top 25 most visited. And today there's only 4 directors of top 25 most visited museums that are run by women, and yet 70% of art museum curators are women. And so I think that also, too, the fact that the top 3 art museums in the world, in terms of visitor figures, which are the Louvre, the British Museum, and the Metropolitan Museum of Art in New York, these are the really high-profile, most frequented visitor figures in the world. These have never had a female director. So I think that tonight's kind of kicking off a debate around this, and I'm hoping also too to open questions at the end from the audience, so be thinking of them as we're going along. And I think it's also important to remember that art museums really shape how we define whose art and what kinds of culture count. And because museums often frame the world for us, sometimes literally, it's important to remember that museum directors often decide what goes on the walls and in the galleries, and thereby kind of determines what the audience thinks is important and what people who visit museums remember. And yet, when we were planning this series, one thing that I hadn't been thinking of, and which I now see after talking to some of our panelists and also thinking around the subject, is that, of course, it's not just gender that matters, despite the title of our series. I think we need to be really open to the fact that we need more of all kinds of people working in the sector. And I agree with Courtauld alumna Kaywin Feldman, who is the director of the Minneapolis Institute of Art. She said that we are a stronger, healthier, and more relevant profession the more diverse we are in every possible way. So I'm looking forward to pulling in those strands of a broader question of diversity in tonight's discussion. And of course, there have been some reports on the lack of diversity and gender parity in the arts sector, both published in the United States, a 2014 investigation commissioned by the American Alliance of Museums Association, as well as a 2015 study published through support of the Arts Council England. And these reports have really highlighted the kind of long way we have to go. But I think that also there are, as Alex mentioned, some kind of green shoots of hope. And I think that will come out tonight in the conversation. But really, the kind of focus of the discussion tonight is going to be about why do we care? And why is gender parity in the arts and the broader question of diversity, why does it matter? So the format tonight is each of our panelists is going to have the floor for a few minutes, and then we'll have a debate amongst the panel, a conversation, and then we'll take questions from the audience. So I'm absolutely delighted to welcome, now that I've welcomed you, to welcome our panelists this evening. We're really very honored to have such an interesting and accomplished group of participants. Our first speaker is going to be Ivona Blaszczyk, who's the director of the Whitechapel Art Gallery. And Debbie was going to take that first slot, but since she's in transit, we'll send it over to Ivona if she doesn't mind. You all should have received handouts that have the biographies of the speakers, so I don't want to spend too much time detailing that, but just to summarize that Ivona has been at Whitechapel since 2001, and is a curator, critic, and lecturer, and has written widely on the subject of contemporary art, including monographs and articles, and has published extensively on themes and movements in modern and contemporary art. The next speaker after will be Sara Wajid, who's head of interpretation at Birmingham Museum and Art Gallery, and founder of Museum Detox. Sara comes to us soon to then go to a new job at the Museum of London, where she is going to continue her work with interpretation and museum engagement. And Sara's founding of Museum Detox has really started as a network for Black, Asian, minority ethnic museum workers. And prior to her work in museums, she worked as a journalist specializing in cultural politics and post-colonial literature. And then following Sara's talk, we have Hannah Philp, who's Director of Marketing at Witten Investment Trust and founder of the East London Fawcett Society. Hannah's work at Witten is a FTSE 250 investment company, but she has, a side job in promoting women in the arts with her work at the Fawcett Society, and also is opening shortly a private members club dedicated to the interests of women in London called Forum. So that is going to be our next panelist. And then following on from Hannah, we have Ed Bamfield, who joins us tonight as our last speaker, and he's partner and head of arts and culture practice at the executive search firm Saxon Bamfield. He's worked in the field since 2005, and he leads the firm's arts and culture practice and works with international museums and institutions, some of whom are represented here tonight. So we're welcoming him as well to speak. So after that short introduction, I'd now like to turn it over to our first speaker, Mona.
Should I stay here?
Yes.
Thank you. So first of all, I wanted to say, it's not so bad. We're not, actually. We're very pioneering. And I think we're at the forefront of all the arts in terms of trying to achieve gender parity. So for example, a year or so ago, I looked at the Proms, which is this BBC-sponsored event of classical music, 100 days at the Royal Hall. Of that 100 days of amazing programmes, there was one female composer, one, and no female conductors. Look at the film world. 2 years ago, top five films, The Revenant, one man, American white male, takes on the wilderness. British spy, one American male, takes on the Soviet Union. The Martian, one American male, takes on outer space, and so on. And the BBC itself, who can forget the recent disclosures about the massive disparity between men and female journalists and presenters. So in that context, I think we're pretty good. In London alone, we have Frances Morris, Maria Balshaw, Jan Thiel, Margot Heller, all running key institutions. And we have a Turner Prize, which has increasingly presented female artists. And I'm very proud to say at the Whitechapel Gallery, we have the Max Mara Art Prize for Women. And last year we gave a platform to the National Museum of Women in the Arts, the only collecting institution in the world dedicated to female artists. So I think huge strides have been done. The other thing, looking at contemporary practice, 100 years ago, artists of the avant-garde situated themselves in an equal relation with the past. History was a burden to be destroyed or thrown off. 100 years later, in 2017, we've seen a whole decade of practitioners obsessed with history, obsessed with archives and the past. Why is that? Why are they going back through the dusty archives? Why? Because of the great lacunae in the official narratives, in the canon. And as the international world, the international art world, which used to be Paris, Dusseldorf, New York, not even London, when I was a baby curator, is now recognizing as a global art world with multiple modernisms, as artists from different regions come to prominence, or those artists who, by virtue of gender, have been invisible in history, they are going back and shining a spotlight on all those lacunae. So I think it's been very interesting to see this so-called archival turn over the last decade, and how artists, I would say, have been in the absolute forefront of pioneers in redressing the balance of geography, gender, of looking at identity as a cause of invisibility. However, on the not-so-good side, we were all asked to address different topics, so I've just chosen two. And my first question to ourselves is, looking at the art market, we've just had the freeze art fair, and the auction houses are gearing up for their autumn sales. Why is it that when so many great female artists of different generations have finally reached worldwide recognition, there is such a disparity in their prices. It is massive, absolutely massive. If you look at the difference between a Marc Roscoe and Louis Bourgeois, it is many, many millions. Why is that? And the question there, I think, reflects really on our ecosystem, the complexity of our ecosystem. But it also points to the fact that who is buying the work or who's not buying the work, what drives a collector, public or private, to make that investment? And I think that's a key question for us. And as public collections are becoming bolder, more courageous, I would say, in moving their resources to supporting the acquisition of being an artist, there's no question about that. The Tate has moved right in that direction, as has MoMA, I believe. I can't speak for the Centre Pompidou, being those three being perhaps the most pivotal institutions in the presentation and acquisition of modern contemporary art. But in the private sector, it's very different. And I think it points to the fact that art has become an asset class. And so many people buying at what we call the top end of the market, the blue chip artists, are looking for a solid investment. And they look to invest in something that they might recognise. They might be masters of the universe, whose values of a testosterone-driven, you know, libertarian perhaps, or mastery about dominating the money markets or property development somehow find their expression through a masculine virtues in art. Perhaps that's the reason. There's also the hesitation at buying in the middle. So a lot of galleries have closed recently who have worked for years in promoting artists, taking them from an emergent status to introducing them to a wider market. And those galleries are not surviving because people want to park their money in a safe haven. On the other hand, emerging artists are doing, or very, very grassroots galleries are doing quite well because people still want to somehow gamble, take a chance with not very much investment. So how does one address that imbalance? How does one, for example, deal with the fact that historically women who found themselves excluded from the canon inevitably had to go elsewhere? So if they couldn't penetrate the halls of painting, for example, or sculpture, that meant that they were looking to other forms like live art, like performance, or to moving image work, or to photography. The lens-based work, the work where their own bodies were subject and object, which is characteristic of what I see as the last great avant-garde of the 20th century, which is feminism, it's not very subtle, perhaps. Perhaps that's the reason. Perhaps an object-based market finds it very difficult to acquire time-based work. Maybe that's it. Another reason that occurred to me, and I'd love to have all our thoughts on this, is eclecticism. There's a lot of practice amongst women artists that I'm aware of, for example, an artist called Rosemary Truckle, who works, she makes watercolours, but she also makes environments, and she works short films, and she also makes tapestries and so on. And collectors perhaps want a trophy work, a work that when any one of us walks into their sitting room, we say, ah, you have a Gerhard Richter. And they want that sort of recognition. So I'm just asking myself, is that move towards non-traditional art forms, non-object-based forms, and practices part of the reason why women haven't been recognised in terms of market value? The second topic I wanted to bring up, it relates to the workshop and gallery and our location in a very particular part of the city. It's very cosmopolitan, very dynamic, but it also has high levels of impoverishment. And I was sort of personally kind of upset when I realised that three young ladies, 15 years old, born and bred in the East End, wanted to become jihadi brides. They to run off to Syria to be part of this other struggle, but a struggle which also involved their own subordination to a very violent patriarchal culture. It was glamorous, no doubt, but what it required was that they had to give away their rights. And I just thought, why did that happen? We run all these programs, we work with schools, we're an institution dedicated to, you know, reaching out to different communities. What could we have done better? What could art do without being instrumentalized that would have offered a counter narrative? You know, is it about offering, and certainly the women who have found themselves in these kinds of movements, or I was reading about Christian fundamentalists in America and here who stand outside abortion clinics and attack other women, or women who take their daughters for genital mutilation. What on earth inspires someone to do that, to oppress their own child or their own sibling? I mean, it seems so counter to their own self-interest and against any sense of a sorority, of a female solidarity. And so I was thinking, what does that mean in terms of the art world? Is it because they don't see themselves? Is it because you can't be what you can't see, that great quote? Is it that lack of representation? Is it that we're not making it clear that you don't just have to be an artist, there are so many jobs in the art world that could enable a different kind of agency? So that's my second topic that I'd like to throw out and discuss.
Hi, so I'd like to talk to you not about art, but about workers. I want to talk to you about a network that I'm part of, two networks in fact. First that I want to tell you about is Network for Change, which is essentially a network of museum feminists that I'm part of. Mainly because I don't want you to think we're not doing anything. I don't want you to think that museum workers are not active, that we're not activists, that we're not engaged. The picture in terms of numbers and statistics and all of that, it's possible that Deborah was going to cover some of that, so I'll just sketch out some of that very briefly, which is, you're probably aware that this is turning into a sort of pink collar sector, that this is actually predominantly a female workforce in the art world, in the public sector art world, in museum and art gallery world, but that, as some speakers have alluded to, it's still men at the top of the very large institutions. And that's where the iniquity is. But a little bit more of that later. The network that I'm part of was started by another network called the Women Museum Leaders Network. And this is a self-support network, effectively, of some of the most powerful women in the art world, art and museum world, who came together over the last 10 years. And this includes women like Diane Lees, who's the director of the Imperial War Museum, or Ellen McAdam, the director of Birmingham Museum Art Gallery, where I work. And they found themselves being the only woman in the boardroom, the rare woman in conferences of senior managers and museum directors, and felt they needed allies. So they came together and sort of basically developed a self-support network that was working very well for them, but it's a very small club of very senior women in the museum sector. And after 10 years, they realised that they'd developed a lot of social capital in this sort of slightly mysterious, secret group. And at the end of the 10 years, they sort of realised it was time to harness some of this social capital and think about patriarchy beyond, in structural patriarchy, essentially. And so they started an opportunity for 100 women within the sector to sort of emulate their own network. So that was called Confidence Choice Connections, and I was one of the lucky ones who got invited into this programme. And there's five clusters of these groups around the country, two in London, two clusters of 20, and there's 100 of us all together. And in my particular cluster, when we were first all introduced to each other and set up on a sort of weekend residential, we got talking and we thought, this is all great, this is fantastic, you know, a bit of solidarity, we're the chosen ones, what could be better? And then quite quickly we sort of started to realise, actually, then we'll just get a little piece of the pie. And nothing will really change. So what if a bunch of middle-class white women, and the group is predominantly middle-class white women, end up running the art world instead of a small group of middle-class white men? Do we really need to spend our evenings doing that? Could do Netflix and chill, do lots of other things at the time. Actually, what's going to get us out of bed is not the fact that we are going to get a piece of the pie. We realised we didn't want a piece of the pie, we wanted to smash the patriarchal pie up altogether. So then we started thinking, well, how will we do this? We are a small network, we quite enjoy this cosy social capital that we're developing for ourselves, and it is quite empowering, and we want to keep that. But we also want to reach out to our allies and think about patriarchy more structurally and have a kind of serious conversation about some of the deep-rooted conceptual issues at work and forces at work in particular museum and art world that we're not willing to tolerate anymore. And so we kind of developed a broader network, which was started by hosting a conference last year at the Imperial War Museum and inviting pretty much any women who wanted to join us in the sector of this conversation. And we wanted this to have a more campaigning tone, so we invited Shani Chakrabarti as our keynote speaker, and we asked a feminist sociologist, Normal Bloir, to do a pilot ethnographic study into women museum leaders. And that was fascinating, because she spoke to about 7 or 8 extremely senior women in the sector, and reported back from them, what's their experience? What's it like to be the women? What's it like to be Diane Lees? And she anonymized these responses and fed them back to us, to the rest of the sector. And these women were saying things like, basically reporting experiences of hyper-surveillance. I feel I put on a fake posh voice. I feel I have to be super conscious of what I wear, etc. And these were sort of people recognised these experiences that they had never been spoken about and publicly platformed. And it was sort of like a confessional for all of these frustrations that women in senior levels had had. And it mobilised. And we started to realise that Noel had sort of pinpointed these 3 things in particular, which the women in very senior levels, and this is not by any means specific to the museum world, experience a sort of hyper-surveillance that men in senior leadership don't experience. And this is extremely disempowering. And by hyper-surveillance, I mean every little move they make, every mistake, every flaw, scrutinised in a way that male leaders who are perceived as the norm would not be. Another thing that's very common amongst women leaders is that they get given organisations, opportunities to lead organisations when those organisations are in crisis. So you kind of set up to fail in some ways. If a museum sort of looked like it might just be going down the pan, that's when a woman's most likely to be kind of leading it. And the third thing was that men, like Tristram Hunt, get appointed on their potential for a job. Women do not. Women get appointed for having demonstrated that they've already done this and they've probably done it for about 15 years already. Whereas many men, also like the director of the National Portrait Gallery, Nicholas Cullman, I don't pick on these men, I'm just giving you these quite concrete examples. He had never been a manager. He was a 37-year-old curator, was put in charge of the National Portrait Gallery. That's not happening to women. So these were the issues of the patriarchal sort of levers of power that we were much more interested in negotiating. Not so much in the numbers, because as I said, the numbers are more complex, and you'll hear more from Ed on this. And outside London, the picture is very different too. So this is what we wanted to kind of grapple with. And as the momentum started to build in this campaign, I started to wonder why for a pink collar kind of sector, as we were becoming, are we relatively quiet about underrepresentation of women in collections and displays? It's not just who's in the building, who's staffing the building. It's what are we displaying and how are we telling those narratives? Not just women artists, but I was at the National Maritime for a long time, National Maritime Museum, and it's the sense of the, sort of Nelson, Admiral Nelson being a classic example, the active agent, the hero, the great men of history. Those stories are still remarkably persistent, even in museums where women are pretty much running the show. Why are we not having these conversations? Why are these discussions about patriarchy not filtering through to display? There are some very deep-seated kind of power issues going on there. So the other network that I wanted to tell you about is the Museum Detox Network that Sonic obviously an issue, but not as big an issue as micro-image in this sector. My experience of that is pretty much why I started the Museum Detox Network. I was in an uncomfortable meeting with some senior managers, and I was raising the issue about the fact that a conference had been organised about the artist being Sean Barr at the museum, and there were no non-white speakers. I thought this wasn't my territory, it wasn't my department, but an outside art curator, a friend of mine, an art historian, had contacted me about this and said, this is appalling, why have I not been invited, why have so-and-so not been invited? So I raised this, and there was a sort of, with another colleague, senior white curator, and I found myself disempowered in that conversation, and I couldn't quite think why, given how experienced I was and so forth. And after a while, after leaving that meeting, I thought, something's going on where I'm spending a lot of energy in a way that I'm not seeing some of my senior white colleagues spending energy, and I'm leaking that energy, and I'm not having it anymore. So I found black workers, basically, at other museums and galleries, and connected with them. And that's been going, this network now, for about 3 years, and there's over 100 of us who are connected to each other. And we're mostly women of colour, and we're quite determined to change things. And I'm not sure that everybody in the network would use the term activist, but we basically are all activists, really. The sort of activities that we're doing, the conversations that we're having, the way that we're mobilising, the impact that we're having. And this is a sort of a new generation, I think, of museum workers who are really committed to, well, frankly, if you're going to in London, commit yourself to a life of underpaid public sector work, you better have a really good reason to do it. You either kind of stay in and get stuck in, or you move on to a more kind of economically sensible vocation. And so I've now been working in Birmingham for a year or so on an experimental exhibition display, which is about decolonising collections. And in that, I'm working with a group of cultural activists who are all black, Asian cultural activists, women, and with a small group team of curators and interpretation specialists and community engagement specialists. And we are, bar one, all women. The most difficult thing to talk about, the most difficult points, are really about white privilege. It's not about feminism. The issues are not about patriarchy. They are about deep entrenched issues in collections, particularly collections relating to empire. And it's really through having a network like the Museum Detox Network and the solidarity and the kind of intellectual capital that is developed through that network. Many of my pals from both networks are here today. Great to see you all. That gives us the energy to do that type of work, which will then have an impact on collections and displayed audiences.
Thank you very much, Sarah. And I was just going to before Hannah types in, might be a good moment for Debbie to join us, and also, are you happy, Debbie, to say your piece?
Yeah, I'm not sure what piece I have to say, so I apologize because I'm not huge well prepared. I certainly don't have lots of stats and statistics, so I'm hoping Ed will be able to supply. Sorry, Ed, you're at the end of the panel.
That's
fine. Don't give all the stats. Just apologize for being late. Multitasking is great, except for British Rail, or not British Rail, whatever it is, great restaurant. And the reason I was to pull the two halves today was because of an extremely, in my view, important conference going on in Oxford Atlantic tomorrow, which is about partition of the subcontinent. So it's very much dealing with issues of history, of memory, of diversity, and so on. So how do you square that circle? You can't. In a sense, I'm picking up on some themes that I think both Iwona and Sarah were talking about. As usual, I think the anecdotal. So it's not thematic, it's not conceptual, it's not whatever, it's just sort of personal experience. I'm old. I'm a lot older than these guys. And so my experience and my perceptions and it is everything I do, I think, is coloured by the history that I come from. And no doubt I would classify as the white middle class, everything else. I started my career certainly within the University of Cambridge, which was my first employment. I certainly experienced all these male domination, like in many forms, many covered, some overt. And certainly I felt in a job, I think, for exactly those reasons, and that triggered me to move to London and to the V&A. At the V&A, I moved into what I felt was a much more gender-neutral environment. It felt totally different from Cambridge. I mean, totally different. And I remember going back to Cambridge sometime after and being sort of horrified and shocked at going back into a very male environment, finding myself a single, you know, the only woman in a room of 200 men, and having exactly that surveillance that you're talking about. I didn't feel any of that surveillance at the V&A and haven't subsequently. At the V&A, thinking about leadership. Leadership is difficult. Leadership for anybody is difficult. Frankly, management of people is difficult. You know, it's not just difficult for us wherever we are, but it's difficult for everybody. I worked at the V&A under five directors. Each of them did wonderful things in their time there. Four of the five, were credited consistently with all the positive things that their predecessors had done. One of them wasn't. That was Elizabeth Estelle Cole, the first woman director of a national arts institution in this country. But that was in 1987 to 1995. The 1994 was a long time ago. But if you think about rewriting history, and this is a bit of history that I, if nobody else has ever bothered it myself, if you Google Elizabeth Estelle Cole, you get a Wikipedia entry which is neutral, factual, and perfectly fine, which deals with her, her history in absolutely skeletal form. Her time at the V&A, her various roles elsewhere, including the vice chancellorship at the University of East Anglia, and does touch on the fact that she had to retire after 2 years because she had multiple sclerosis. That didn't stop her subsequently from doing many things, including chancellor of Lincoln University. The second entry in Google is a 1995. I can't remember which paper it is. Times or Telegraph, one of the mainstream papers. Absolutely vicious commentary from Peter Popper, I think, purportedly describing her directorship, in which she. I could read it, but it's almost too distasteful to read it. In the sense, the word access is absolutely vilified, as being very bad. The use of the word mission is vilified. Everything that she purportedly did, but it throws away the fact that under her aegis, a full scientific conservation centre was set up, and it certainly made no reference to the many, many, what are called unglamorous infrastructural things that she did to set the foundations for everything the V&A subsequently achieved. Digitization of the record of the collections, redoing all the storage, all those really, really boring housekeeping things. But actually, typically women are much better doing that, I have to say. But it was distressing to me to go back and look at that and see that even now, this really sort of plays to, I think, your own point about the histories, that in that world, in the institutional arts world, in the public institutional arts world, the histories of women's participation and leadership has not been told correctly. And clearly, I think you guys, you need to know that. I mean, there was a great woman leader of a great national institution in the 1980s. It's a long time ago. And history of that is sort of without trace. She wasn't very much alone. There weren't many others. The other thing that she did, and again, neutrally, was to ensure that middle managers, middle curators, middle other exhibitional were given a really strong sort of background and training and development. In other words, there was a training and development department set up to ensure that those who were showing already some leadership and management potential could gain experience. Time off, time to do it, every single one of us went on to lead major institutions. And it's interesting, I mean, and this was something that she introduced as well, right across the piece. I think parallel set of continuous in the National Museums, but perhaps not with quite the verve, the vigour, and the enthusiasm to make a significant change that she did. It didn't deal with the diversity issue, but she was starting a piece problem for implicitly wasting time with the Korean gallery, the Japanese gallery, the Indian gallery, etc. Now, the diversity was also, as you might imagine, was also on her, you know, other forms of diversity on her agenda. So the two so often go together. But I could, in a way, I could say that you know, my career has been relatively easy in some ways. It's certainly been slow, in the sense that I've been old because I thought, well, I've got to a leadership position quite late in life, so why give it up now? Maybe one can have some impact. So I do represent that in a different sort of way. And I think to look at those trajectories statistically, as clearly some of you have done in a more coherent way than I have, I think is very revealing. But I think what I would want to say is that, and clearly both of you are doing this in spades and in a variety of different ways, is that role models of all sorts are absolutely critical. For me, Elizabeth was a major role model, along with others in the cohort. And she had an extremely bad time. I mean, extremely. I mean, she was vilified because she was forced by implicit government pressures and money to make a number of people voluntarily redundant. That is what always invoked when her name was raised. That woman, they say, that woman. And it possibly was a mistake on her part, but it was a mistake made for her to follow. She filled, I think, exactly the model that you're invoking still of now. Way back then, with someone who perhaps wasn't as experienced in playing politics. She went to a National Audit Committee meeting and was challenged about the state of the VNA, because she had been quite honest in saying, well, actually, it's in a pickle. You know, it's in a mess. She was honest. Not everybody is honest, probably political is not necessarily, being honest is not very astute politically, perhaps. And she got, in a sense, doubly punished for that. So she absolutely fits into that picture. All things that she did, at a point of crisis, you could argue with the VNA, were the benefits were picked up by others afterwards, who happened to be men, and still are. But so I learned a huge amount, I suppose, in terms of direct practical experience, in terms of models. I happen not to be someone who's very good at networking formally or being formally political. I just sit in the job and try and do it. But I think I'm getting more political now, latterly, ironically, probably too late, but in the sense that much more speaking out is needed, implicit campaigning, certainly absolute rigour and focus on what we're trying to achieve, and looking coherently at ways of achieving that in terms of proactive event and activity. And maybe here at the Court of India, we could move things further forward. In terms of gender, our staffing is more female than male now. I think our board is technically 50-50 gendered, but that's ignoring the skew between staff members of the board and laymen of the board. Our ethnic diversity is appalling. And we need to do much more on that. So I just want to say what I couldn't say at the beginning. I hugely welcome this initiative that some of these people have. Because I think it's part of, as Sarah said, it's part of a much wider debate. It is certainly about gender, but it's also about all sorts of other forms of diversity and prejudice, you know, implicit, often implicit prejudice.
Thank you very much. Over to you, Hannah.
Hello. So for me, it's a huge privilege to be here. I don't actually work in the arts or for a museum, so I feel very lucky to get to spend spend some time in some, within Somerset House and the Courtauld Institute. As Ivana mentioned, and is absolutely right, the arts isn't necessarily the worst industry for gender representation, and I'm sort of here talking in very general terms about feminism, about gender parity in the workplace, and maybe a little bit about some things that I think women can do or that women can ask for to make change in those ways. I am at the moment a director of marketing for a FTSE 250 company. I work in, it's an investment company, I work in finance, and I've spent 7 years in the industry, and before that I worked in politics, both industries heavily dominated by men, quite different from the arts in that respect, and where the culture, the agenda, the working practices were all and are all defined by men. That's not to say I've been treated appallingly or suffered kind of overt sexism, although I have been witness to some of it, but it's more a case of unconscious bias and some of the structural biases that exist that make it quite difficult for women to get on in those industries. However, what's led me to think about creating a third space for women, which is what I'm going to do next year, and open a sort of community social club for women that is outside of the home and different from the workplace, but is about their productivity and fulfillment, was talking to women across all sorts of different industries and coming to recognise that the workplace seems to be a place that, you know, the rules are almost set by men. And I'm incredibly hopeful, listening to these talks before, that that might be changing, and also changing with more women leaders. So I am obviously very passionate about gender equality. I'm an advisor to the 50-50 Parliament campaign, and I work with a number of grassroots feminist charities and organisations and supporting them with their kind of marketing and campaigning. But this is an issue that's vitally important to everyone. So like taking a step back at the total top line, if women were participating in the labour force in the same way as men, so if they were working the same hours and across the same sectors, that would contribute, or that would add something like $28 trillion to global GDP, which is the equivalent of a United States or a China. GDP is something that maybe makes your eyes glaze over, and even working in finance, it has the same effect for me, but it's basically a measure of productivity. So it's something that is really important and a problem that everybody should be engaged with thinking about. In order to engage more women in the workforce, it's a question of getting more women into work, aligning their pay, shifting women into productive sectors, and most importantly, which I think probably is most relevant to this conversation, getting women into leadership roles. Although I don't work in the arts, and I'm not necessarily, I don't have experience in the arts in the same way as the rest of the panel, I am a patron and I love the arts, and I actually believe that it's one of the few sectors, I don't actually know of many sectors where it matters more that there is gender parity. Because art essentially is obviously what it represents what we see, what we think, how we feel about the world. And if it only represents white male consciousness, it's kind of an appalling state of affairs, really, and it makes art kind of not meaningful, enjoyable, or relevant to everybody in society. And I really do think that diversity in the arts, and that has to be focused on arts leadership, equals the potential for art to be more meaningful, more important in society. I spend a lot of time thinking about why there might be a gender gap, because definitely as a middle-class white woman, a lot of people, you know, assume that I kind of have equality. I have a hell of a lot of privilege as a result of that, but I definitely witness a lot of unconscious bias at the same time. Not necessarily of my own, but also of people that are facing other challenges because of class, race, disability, and so on. And it's not necessarily about being fired for
one of those reasons from your job or being overtly offered less pay for that, but it's about quite a lot of more subtle things at play. And I think that the three most important of these factors are unpaid labour. So in this country, women undertake 60% more unpaid labour than men. And that's not just women who have children or who look after elderly relatives, but it's women who are responsible for doing the washing up or washing clothes or for taking on a lot of the domestic responsibilities that oftentimes seem irrelevant to our professional careers, but actually fundamentally can impact on the amount of time and energy that women have to do other things with their lives and their careers. And this most kind of acutely impacts women aged 26 to 35. So I had assumed before kind of understanding this problem a little bit that it was something that affected, I don't have any children and I don't have elderly relatives, but it affected women a lot older than me. But actually, it's very early on in women's careers where they face this double burden, and at the time when they maybe need to be putting in as much energy as possible into their careers. The second is entrenched leadership, so something that the panelists have all spoken about, but exactly as has been said, you cannot be what you can't see. Leadership is incredibly important in setting aspirations for the rest of the organisation and for determining, you know, future belief in yourself. And that links into my last point and the thing that I actually think is most important, which is a confidence gap, which not only affects women, but also affects women and men of colour and people with different and other challenging circumstances. But it has been shown, there's a great book actually called The Confidence Code, which I'd recommend to everybody, but it was two women, female journalists from the United States undertook some research across the whole of the world looking into what actually equals kind of success in the workplace. And they found that confidence has as much of an impact on your success at work as competence does, which, I mean, judging by your reactions, it wasn't something I was surprised by either. It almost was kind of like a light bulb going off in my head and suddenly understanding, you know, some of my frustrations working alongside male colleagues for like the last 10 to 12 years and wondering why they were being promoted ahead of me when I was, you know, really diligently and kind of behaving and doing my work. But, you know, they had a lot more confidence, I think. And I don't actually lack a huge amount of confidence either. But women are, they tend to consider themselves not ready for promotions, they predict that they'll do worse in tests, and they doubt their abilities more than men. And this then feeds into some of the things that I sort of keep a log of, as sort of things that I could, and that I encourage my friends to do more of in the workplace. One of them is to feel entitled. So to spend more time actually focusing on what you want to achieve and training yourself to feel entitled to that. And the more that you read and you listen and you understand this kind of problem of confidence, the more that you kind of come to terms with how much you are holding yourself back from some of the things that you're doing. The second is being focused upwards. So within an organization or a company, really understanding what the goals of that organization are, what the bottom line is and how your role contributes to that is so important. There's a woman I was kind of, who has been a bit of a mentor to me, and I was lucky enough to have lunch with her a few weeks ago, and she's chair of a number of different companies, including a FTSE 100 company, so one of the biggest companies in the country. And I said to her, you know, what is the secret to success? And she kind of fumbled around that question a little bit, but she said one thing that she's always stuck by throughout her entire career is delivering for whatever company that she works for and really understanding what they are trying to go for. And that sounds quite basic, but it's almost going beyond the scope of your role and thinking how it contributes. And then you can position yourself into a place where you can ask for more pay or for promotion and so on. Another thing that I found really helpful recently, which is slightly different from sort of meeting this woman for lunch, months, which is actually peer mentoring and establishing a group of professional women. They don't necessarily even need to be in the same industry, where you can share some of your grievances and problems with in quite an honest way, and learn about some of theirs and how they've tackled those challenges. But saying all that, I definitely don't want to promote the fact that it is entirely women's responsibility to fix this problem. I'm a massive believer in quotas and in structural change. There's this ridiculous assumption that the status quo is fair and that there aren't existing structural biases in place that mean, you know, women face some unfair challenges. And so I do see it as completely fair that we can introduce short-term structural change to actually achieve equality in the future. And my understanding of quotas is being quite focused around business and particularly investment and financial companies. And there was a great initiative introduced that called the 30% Club, which was basically an initiative to target 30% of women on boards of the UK's largest companies. And there was a hell of a lot of pushback in my industry against this, and, you know, oh, it ought to be a meritocracy, and the same old sort of arguments against quotas. But actually, begrudgingly, you know, companies were forced to come around to this. And the outcome of that, the introduction of those quotas, hasn't just been more women on boards, which is excellent, but it's also been a change to the entire industry, where there are now more recruitment companies focused on recruiting women, there are more initiatives focused on training women, and a greater number of mentoring schemes. So I do think that quotas are a short-term solution, but they can help in sort of changing the circumstances of an industry for women. And I look forward to discussing some of those in more depth.
Thank you very much. Now over to Ed. Thank you.
Good evening. So I feel really lucky to have a really interesting job. What I do most days is I work with really amazing museums, galleries, and other arts and cultural institutions to help find their senior leaders, be they directors, people on leadership teams, or people to go on board. And so yeah, I think maybe for this today, I can maybe add a little bit of context to the kind of people that I'm meeting along the way and the kind of experiences that I'm coming up to. Alongside that, I spent a lot of time thinking about the nature of leadership in this sector. We've commissioned a research report, which we published this autumn, about succession planning in arts and culture. We've interviewed 41 senior leaders, both in the UK and globally. And diversity, particularly diversity in leadership, is a key topic for those people that we spoke to. So two or three things came to mind about this question. The first is slightly echoed by a couple of other panelists, but I feel cautiously optimistic about gender in the arts. Yes, at the very top level, those 25 most visited museums, the picture is not good. But if you go one or two rungs below, I think the picture looks quite different. And I don't come on with lots of stats, I'm afraid, but I did just have a quick glance down at, for example, the Plus Tate Network of visual arts organisations, over half of which are run by women, that's nationally, and Arts Council's major part of museums, over half of which are run by women. The people I meet day to day, my long lists are often more than half women, long and short lists when you're building up candidates for employment. And regularly I work with senior leadership teams that are either all female or in the majority female. So, you know, I think Sarah talks about, you know, becoming a pink collar profession, maybe. Certainly reflected in my experience, and it doesn't feel like an old boys club in that regard. And I kind of hope that these really large, prestigious organisations, it might be a bit of a pipeline issue. And as more candidates get more experience, that pitch will also change in the future. The second thing I think, you know, whether we have gender parity there or we don't, is probably on non-executive boards. And I also do recruitment for chairs and trustees of arts organisations. And the picture there looks very different. You know, even if you look around, the board is a public thing, it says something about the organisation, and people do look at it. And they are, for the most part, male and often white. And I think that is harder. Members of the board, trustees, they're often recruited for complementary skills don't come from the arts and culture sector. I think the arts and culture sector does really well in this, and obviously that's not replicated in other areas, as we've heard. I think there's also a thing about how trustees are recruited. If you don't use a wonderful search firm like us, you have to go and tap people on your shoulder, and you know, there's limited networks, and it just kind of replicates as what you've already got. When we do chairs particularly, the experience is required, and also the huge amount of pressure that the job of the chair has often makes organisations risk averse, and the women that do fit the criteria are called all the time about all the chair jobs, obviously don't have the capacity to do them. So I think there's a lot to sort of think about there when we can unpack that a bit in the discussion. The final thing I just sort of reflection on is, male or female, the bulk of the people that I meet as candidates, and on leadership teams, are white and are middle class. And I think thinking about other ways that the sector can be more representative, the barriers to entry into the sector and the barriers to progression upwards seem higher